Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We got an extra hour of sleep last night, so that should be reason enough to rejoice, but even more reason is we are together now in this new way. We're grateful to be together today for worship as Hillier Memorial Christian Church. Take a moment if you are logged into Facebook this morning. Let us know that you're here and that you're watching. Give us a chance to greet one another in the comments. Sarah Seibert, our Director of Christian Education, is moderating those comments as usual. We'll celebrate communion later in the service, so please do make sure you've got something that you and your family can use for communion elements when we get to that part of the service. Today is All Saints Day, and we're going to begin together singing "Shall We Gather at the River." I hope you'll sing along with me at home. Shall we gather at the river, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, beautiful, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. On the margin of the washing up its silver spray, we will walk and worship ever all the happy golden day. Yes, we'll gather at the river, beautiful, beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, lay we every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide a robe and crown. Yes, we'll gather at the beautiful, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. That flows by the throne of God. Amen. Now I'm going to invite our acolyte today, my son Luke, to light the Christ candle for us, to remind us that God is in our midst and Christ binds us together in this time of worship. If you and your family have a candle at home, I encourage you to light that now to remind you and to remind each of us that Christ is with us always, no matter where we may be. Now, friends, I want to invite you to gather your children around for another special children's moment with Sarah, and she is at a very special place today. So let's tune in and listen now.
Today, I am greeting you from Camp Caroline, because this place is a very special place to remember all of the people who know and love Jesus in our congregation and in so many other places. Let's see if we can find some people who have been in this place who love Jesus just as much as we do. I wonder if you know the name of this person. This picture has been here for a long time, and you might see it every time you go and eat a meal at Camp Caroline. But perhaps you've never noticed before the little plaque under the picture. It says this woman's name was Caroline. And that's how the camp got its name. Caroline, Conwell, Godwin is one person that we can remember at Camp Caroline who loves Jesus just like we do. What do you notice about these bricks? It looks like some of them have writing on them. This one says, in honor of our pastor, Reverend Dr. Leah Slayton, Wilson's Mills Christian Church. This one says, sing for joy as you walk with the Lord, Kevel family. This one says, Kloss Barker Class, Broad Street Christian Church, New Bern, North Carolina. All of these bricks have names of people who have loved Camp Caroline. Even some people that we know. Today, our church is celebrating what we call All Saints Day, which is another way of saying all of the people that loved Jesus. When we see names like these, we remember that there are people all around the world and all throughout time who love Jesus, and that we are part of one big family.
Thank you, Sarah. Well, today, friends, we begin a new worship series and our annual stewardship campaign. Our theme this year is We Walk by Faith. The life of our church looks different now than it has ever before. This year has brought so many unexpected challenges and unimagined circumstances and an uncertain future. And friends, it would be easy to look at this current moment and be filled with anxiety, but sometimes our eyes can deceive us. So Paul reminds us not to look at what can be seen, but to look at what cannot be seen. We walk by faith and not by sight. So in these uncertain times, we look with the eyes of our hearts to walk by faith, trusting in God's abiding presence and amazing grace. Hilliard, that's exactly what you have been doing. Your commitment to our church and your faithfulness to God has been fully evident in your ongoing financial support of our congregation's work this year. So on behalf of our finance committee and our church council and our staff, I first and foremost just want to say thank you. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for keeping the faith. Our request this year as we begin this stewardship campaign is really quite simple. Keep up the good work. Keep up the good work. Your ongoing, consistent support continues to make possible all of the life-changing ministries of our church, like children's and youth ministry and camp ministry and music ministry and our local outreach and mission and our morning worship services and so much more. So we invite you, friends, to recommit to that support in this coming year if you can. You can complete your pledge online at any time at hillyourchurch.org/give. And you've got the option when you go there of setting up a recurring gift if you'd like to do that. We also have printed pledge cards that we mailed out to those who don't have email, and they're more available in the church office if you'd like them, and you can return those printed cards by mail or drop them off during office hours. Hilliard, we walk by faith. We had quite a journey in 2020, and you have just kept moving forward, trusting God every step of the way. Let's keep on the path together in 2021 as with the eyes of our hearts, we look to the bright future that God has in store for us. Now let's listen, friends, for a moment as some of our dear Hillier saints share their dreams for our church. Then we've got a message from our regional minister and a wonderful song from Ross Williams. So let's listen together now.
Well, my dream for Hillier is that we can carry what we get from attending church on Sunday into the neighborhood that we live and work in every day of the coming week. That we aren't afraid to mention Christ to those that we talk to or those that we meet. And Hillier has made a difference in my life. Since I was a young girl at Hillier, I have seen many changes over the years, but they still come full circle to celebrate God in our lives. I have seen so much joys and sorrows, and know that we have to hold on as best we can, depending on the Lord's word to carry us through. I know that He can do this. I love to see my Christian friends, whom I love, and I know that they love me. And I'm glad I have Hillier, because for me personally, this church is a continuation of life as I know it, and the lives of those touched by its vision for the future. This pandemic has changed our lifestyles so much, but Hillier and other churches have come to our rescue and have held church as effectively as possible.
Blessed by the legacy that's ours, may Hillier always provide for all people a sanctuary where they may worship, study, and learn, and find opportunities for service. It is my prayer that the genuine hospitality and the love of God will always be given and received there.
My dream for Hillier is that it can continue to be a vital part of our downtown community, that it will provide a haven and a place of hope, that it provides peace for people, that we are working and serving a diverse congregation, that we continue to have opportunities for us to learn about God and learn about ourselves. I dream that Hillier will continue to be as strong in its membership, in its love, in its outreach, in its all the good things that make my heart feel good when I think about church.
Greetings, Hillier Memorial Christian Church, from all of your brothers and sisters around the region of North Carolina. What a joy it is to be with you in worship today and to share a scripture with you. But just before I do, please allow me to say to Pastor Troy Tatum and to all of you there, the church family, my church family in Raleigh, how excited I am to see that you are still holding high the banner of what it means to be a disciple of Christ in moments like these. Moments that are tenuous, moments that give us pause and cause us to wonder sometimes, how will we make it? Your creativity and innovation in how to have worship, how to minister to those that are sick, who are in need, or who are emotionally distraught because of the times in which we live. The way you continue to be the church in supporting the local, the district, the regional, and the general church. The way you continue to find ways for outreach and the ways for witness in your community. I read your newsletters. I see how you are moving to support local ministry, support the community to help uplift the hungry, the homeless, to help with education, to help keep the seniors and of the community encouraged, I thank you, Hillier, for keeping your hands to the gospel plow, being a true witness of the word in not only word but deed. And I appreciate your commitment to be the church with voice, not silent, with voice when it comes to justice and reconciliation. I salute you. You truly are a flagship church. Would you join me for the scripture? 1 John 3rd chapter, New International Version, beginning at verse 1, reads as follows. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are the children of God, and what we will be, he has not yet made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope purify themselves just as he is pure. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be unto God. God bless you, Hillier.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my way, where the soul of man never dies. My darkest night will turn to day, where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewells, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. A rose is blooming there for me, where the soul of man never dies. And I shall spend eternity where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewell, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. A love light beams across the phone, where the soul of man never dies. It shines and lights the way to home, where the soul of man never dies. Dear friends, there'll be no sad farewells, there'll be no tear-dimmed eyes. Where all is peace and joy and love, and the soul of man never dies. And the soul of man never dies.
Thank you so much, Ross and Valerie and Betsy and Polly and Sue, for sharing with us today. We're so grateful for that. Well, as we have mentioned, today is All Saints Day. Often we celebrate All Saints Day on the first Sunday in November, but today is the actual day. November 1st is All Saints Day, sometimes called All Hallows Day. And while our culture doesn't spend a whole lot of time paying attention to All Hallows Day anymore, we certainly pay a lot of attention to All Hallows Eve, to Halloween, what we had last night, October 31st. Halloween in our culture has, of course, taken a life of its own. You know, it's kind of strange, the idea of dressing up as somebody else and knocking on a stranger's door and begging for candy. It's kind of odd. Especially these days. It used to be a little more common to go knock on your neighbor's door, but when my doorbell rings, I think, you know, something has gone horribly wrong. The dog has gotten out. Are the kids getting arrested? What's happening? But on Halloween, it's one of those few times when we actually get to talk to our neighbors, and we come out of our houses into the neighborhood, and we act like a real community. And I think that's a wonderful thing. What we do in our neighborhoods on Halloween goes back to those old celebrations of All Saints Day, of All Hallows Day. Years ago, in England especially, kids would dress up, sometimes in costume, as a beloved family member who had passed away, as a departed ancestor. And the kids dressed up as a family member would go door-to-door souling, is what they called it. They'd knock on the door and sing a little song in memory of the ones that they'd lost. Maybe they'd offer a prayer, and then they'd beg for a soul cake in honor of that departed loved one. A soul cake was a small spice cake. It had the sign of the cross baked on the top, and sometimes people would leave out soul cakes at the door, maybe a little wine at the door too. That last part would probably change up trick-or-treating a little bit, I would think. You know, Halloween's been tricky this year. Halloween's been a whole lot trickier this year because of the virus, but I suppose it's still a little easier than what it would have been back in those days of soul cakes. Back in the days when kids dressed up as ordinary saints, as people they know, ancestors or family members, you know. Luke, what do you want to be for Halloween? I think I'll go as Uncle Fred. Well, great. Let's, you know, black out a couple of your teeth and get you a bald cap. How about you, Riley? Who do you want to be? I'll be Aunt Esther. Great. Well, let's get you a bottle of Chardonnay and a purse full of sweet and lows. For decorations, we can, you know, see if we can find something like that green vinyl couch they used to have that looked so classy sitting on their front porch. When we stick with family members, the costume possibilities are, let's say, a little limited. But that misses the fun of Halloween, because I think the big fun of Halloween is asking that question, what are you going to be? What are you going to be? And the possibilities are endless. It's a great question. It's why kids love Halloween. It's why some of us grown-ups love Halloween. For a little while, at least, we get to be whomever we want to be, whether that's a pirate or a superhero or a princess or a unicorn or a walrus or a sloth or, you know, whatever. The possibilities are endless. That's the fun. Recently, on a Halloween a year or two ago, I was out making a hospital visit, and I got on the elevator with a little girl and her mom. And the little girl was, I don't know, 5 or 6 years old, and she was dressed in a pink sparkly dress, and she had a tiara and a scepter and everything. And so I asked, are you a princess? And she shook her head and said, yes, I'm a princess. All right, having a young daughter, I know most of the Disney princesses, but I couldn't place this one. I couldn't figure out who she was. And so I asked, are you a particular princess? And she said, yes, I am Princess Emily. That's my name, she whispered. I had a little chuckle. What will we be? It's a fun question on Halloween. It's a fun question, but most other days, when you get to be a certain age, it's a question that doesn't have all that many answers, just the inevitability of the present. What will we be? Well, today I'm an accountant, and I guess I always will be. I'm a teacher, or I'm a plumber, or I'm a manager, or a salesman, or a pastor, or, you know, whatever. I am who I am. The die has been cast. I'm too old to start over, and I'm too old to pretend. Most of the time, I suppose, it feels like we don't really have a whole lot of choice in the matter. Life is what happens when you're busy making other plans, and life has happened to most of us already. So 5 years turns into 25, and 25 turns into 50, and you wake up one day, and here you are. You are who you are. You are who you will always be. It's settled, isn't it? Maybe it feels that way. Maybe it feels like all the important choices are behind you. Maybe, maybe it feels like you've driven right past the exit ramp. Maybe it feels like this is all there is. And maybe that's a good thing. Maybe you're happy, mostly satisfied. Or I don't know, maybe it feels like it's pushing down on your shoulders like the weight of the world. But either way, it's settled, right? Isn't it? Perhaps it feels that way. But friends, life with God is never settled, never static, never stuck. It is always going someplace new. There are plenty of other religions that tell us that life is a circle, a cycle, a settled system, that time is an illusion and life just keeps spinning and spinning and spinning. But that's not how it works with the God who has been revealed to us in Jesus Christ. With this God, there is a beginning. God speaks creation into being. It hasn't always been here. Before, there was nothing, but then God speaks and time begins. With God, there's a beginning and there is also an end. God's kingdom will come. There will come a time when God finally, ultimately gets what God wants. There will be a culmination to all that God has started. With God, time isn't circular, it's linear. There's a beginning and there's an end, and in the middle, God intervenes. In between, there's a new beginning. In the Gospel of John, we're told that Jesus is the very Word of God made flesh, the Word of God that spoke creation into being. In some ways, that new beginning is the beginning of the end. In Jesus, God is starting to get what God wants. Jesus says, "The kingdom of God is among you now." The kingdom of God has started, the kingdom of God has come, but it hasn't yet come fully. The kingdom has not yet come fully, and nobody needs to tell you that. The pandemic's raging, hatred's boiling over, racism and bigotry are on the rise, not to mention loved ones who are hurting and children who are hungry and people who don't have a place to call home. I don't need to tell you that God's kingdom hasn't come yet. You don't need convincing of that, but sometimes we need a reminder that it has started, that it is coming. And that's why every time we get together, we pray, "Thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come here, now, on earth as it is in heaven. Come quickly, Lord Jesus." God's kingdom will come. That is where all this is heading. That is the hope that we hold on to, the hope that keeps us going. But we don't know when it's going to come. About that day and hour, no one knows, says Jesus. We don't know when, and we don't really know what it's going to look like. All we know is Jesus, and because we know Jesus, we know God. You know, some might say that God is large and God is beyond our comprehension. Well, perhaps, but God has given us Jesus, and when we look at Jesus, we get a good idea of what God looks like. A good idea of what God's kingdom is like. You listen to Jesus and he tells us what God's kingdom is like. It's like a shepherd who had 100 sheep and when one wandered away, he left the 99 behind to go find the lost sheep. It's like a woman who lost a coin and turned the house upside down looking for it and threw a party when she found it. Jesus says, in God's kingdom, the poor are blessed and the hungry are blessed and the meek and the peacemakers are blessed. We do know God. We do. But we don't know exactly what it's going to look like when God comes again. We don't know what it will look like when God comes and we actually listen. And we don't know what we will look like when God comes. And we see Him. We really see. We don't know what we will look like when God gets what God wants. That's what the author of 1 John is saying in that passage that Valerie read earlier. We are God's children now, but what we will be has yet to be revealed. It sounds like Paul. Now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. We don't know the whole story yet. We're stuck living in between, and between the kingdom come and the kingdom coming fully. We're not there yet. We don't know the whole story. We don't have the whole picture, but every once in a while, we get a glimpse. Friends, maybe that's the best definition of the saints of God.
those who allow us through their lives to see God a little more clearly. And what they say and what they do and the way they live and the way they die, their lives give witness to God's grace. These saints give us a little glimpse, a little taste of what God has in store for us, a sneak preview of what will be. We don't fully know the answer to that question. We don't know what tomorrow holds. Maybe we don't know what we will be when all is said and done. But because we know the saints of God and the hope that they have passed on to us, we can live differently now. And that's not just bright hope for tomorrow. That is strength for today. Friends, on this day, we look to the saints of God and we know that we can be more. We can take off our costumes. We can take off our disguise and claim our true identity as children of God. So this morning, I'm thinking about Princess Emily of the Elevator, the one with the pink sparkly dress and the scepter and the tiara. Today, I'm thinking about Princess Emily and how thankful I am that she didn't want to be one of those other princesses. She didn't want to be Snow White or Cinderella or Sleeping Beauty. She didn't want to imagine what it would be like to be them. She looked to them and saw what she wanted to be herself. Not Ariel or Elsa or Rapunzel. Princess Emily. So what will we be? We don't know the whole answer to that question. We are caught in between what God has started in Jesus and what God will complete through Jesus. We don't know the whole story. We don't have the full picture. But John reminds us that we do know this. We are God's children now. So we should live as God's children now. That's who we are, friends. And we should never forget it. Today, we remember the saints of God who lived that truth so clearly that we could not help but see it for ourselves. May we honor their legacy as we walk together in faith. Amen.
Today, friends, we remember the saints of God, the ones who came before us and pointed the way, the ones who took the time to show us what it looks like to follow Jesus, the ones who built their lives on Christ. Because of them, we know what we're capable of. Because of them, we know what God is calling us to. I invite you, friends, to join me in a time of quiet and prayerful reflection as we remember the names of church members and loved ones who've passed away in the last year. Join me as we remember their witness and give thanks to God for their lives and their love. Martin Crow. Naseme Makumbu Andre. Doris Winslow Williams. Charlene Yount. Bobby Land. Bob Gillespie. John Carlton Raper. Donald Winstead. Richard Dick Gowdy. Pat McKay. Joe Walker. James Jim Robbins. Michael Ward Griffin. Rowena Southern. Gerald Radford. Charles Richardson. Hardy Seavers. Mary Kane. Michael Cameron. Would you join me in a time of prayer? Holy and eternal God, thank you for the people that you have put in our lives whose faithful witness to your love teaches and inspires us. As we remember the saints who have gone ahead of us, we remember their example to love and to serve, to welcome and to comfort, to follow you faithfully, patiently, courageously. Help us, Lord, to remember what it means to be called your child, O God. Remind us of our foundation in you. Encourage us to reflect your image in our words, in our actions, and with our lives. Loving God, the generations rise and pass away before you. You are the strength of those who labor. You are the hope of the world. We remember now all who have lived in faith, and especially those most dear to us who rest in you. We thank you for their lives and love, and rejoice with all the communion of saints that your kingdom, O God, will come and come fully, when all will be revealed and we will see you just as you are. Thank you, O God, for the sure foundation of your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray today. Amen.
Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain. But it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits. There's a festival of friends. And we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. I can't explain it. I couldn't if I tried. How the only things we carry are the things we hold inside, like a day in the open, like a love we won't forget, like the laughter that we started and hasn't died down yet. Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, and it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. Oh, now didn't we? And don't we make it shine? Aren't we standing in the center of something rare and fine? Some glow like embers, like a light through color glass. Some give it all in one great flame, throwing kisses as they pass. Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver wings. Life's a twinkling, that's for certain, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. Of Eden, but there's heaven in our midst, and we're never really all that far from the ones we love and miss. Weighed out in the water, there's glory all around, and the wisest say there's a thousand ways to kneel and kiss the ground. Let it go, my love, my truest. Let it sail on silver. burden, but it's such a fine thing. There's a gathering of spirits, there's a festival of friends, and we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again. And we'll take up where we left off when we all meet again.
Here at the Lord's table, friends, we gather with all the saints of God, those who have come before, those who are yet to come, those who are with us now. Here at this table, God's family comes together to reflect, to remember, and to be made whole through the brokenness of Christ. So come, all you saints of God, come, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Let us pray. Good and loving God, we are humbled and grateful that you walk alongside us at this confusing time in our world. In the meal that you shared with your disciples, we see that you do not abandon us, but rather our strength. Thank you, God, for giving us the promise of eternal life. As we gather at the communion table, please bless now the bread and cup as you make your presence known to us. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
And so, friends, we remember the story. How on that night when Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room, he took bread, and after giving thanks for it, he broke it. And he blessed it, and he gave it to them and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you take it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Now, with thanksgiving for the many gifts of God's grace received at this table, let's join our hearts and voices together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my death. Cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my death to pay.
From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. Lord, I lift your name on high.
I love to sing your praises.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
I think we need to end all of our songs like that from now on. That's fantastic. Thank you, Violet and David and Julie, for that special treat today. Now, friends, as you go from this time of worship into a new week of life, carry with you the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit until we're all gathered together around the Lord's table again. Thank you, friends. Thank you to the many, many people who shared their gifts with us in worship this week. Don't forget to share this service with someone who might need a message of hope today. Share it on Facebook or send it to somebody you know who might need this. We would love to get that word out to as many as possible. Now, friends, let's listen as Bill Shelton plays our postlude and we go with God's peace. Take care.